morning. It's News from the Roots on Mountain Stream TV. I'm Avram Friedman. Today is Tuesday, July 23rd, 2019. And we have a guest with us this morning, Carrie McBane from down home North Carolina. Welcome, Carrie, and thanks for being here.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Yeah. Down home is putting on a presentation in Sylva at the Community Services Building.
Right. Technically, it's called the NC Cooperative Extension Space.
Yes.
But I just call it the DMV Center. It's the closest, the easiest way for me to remember. So off of Skyland, it's 876 Skyland. Skyland Drive.
876 Skyland Drive, and that'll be Thursday evening.
Correct. So Thursday the 25th from 5:30 to 7:30.
Okay. And what's the subject matter of this presentation?
So the subject matter is it's a modified version of the documentary called How to Survive a Plague, which actually we at Down Home are trying to raise awareness in our communities about the overdose crisis, the epidemic we're facing now in all of our communities. And so the point of showing the documentary is to show how another group years ago banded together, so to speak, and stood up for themselves and their communities to show the government that they were important, and that the AIDS crisis, which is the documentary is about a group called ACT UP, and that stands for the AIDS Coalition to Unleash Power. And again, that was started back in the 80s when the AIDS epidemic had reached crisis, and how they were being ignored by their communities and particularly the government. And so we are now facing our own, we're already in the midst of the overdose crisis with the opioids and fentanyl and heroin. And so we are looking to model some of our actions after what ACT UP presented and engaged in the 80s during the AIDS crisis.
And so ACT UP was originated in California, I believe. Is that correct? Or where?
I believe it was New York.
New York.
Correct,
okay.
Not California. New York, correct.
Where there's a large gay community.
Correct.
And the HIV crisis was particularly badly impacting the gay community, although it certainly wasn't exclusive to the gay community. I mean, the AIDS crisis impacted the entire population, and I mean, men and women and gay and straight people alike. But the news media at least made it sound as if it was just a gay rights issue, and it really wasn't. I mean,
correct. Well, it's very, the way that crisis was handled or not handled is very similar to what's happening with the overdose crisis we're in now. It's being attributed, and the stigma is attached to, active users or even recovering addicts, that there's something wrong with you. It's just you. It's not us. Mm. The lack of compassion, particularly shown by the government to even get things done, even little things like access to medication, access to health care, to mental services, all these things that the government negated back during the 80s with the AIDS crisis, it's very similar to what we're seeing now. And so we are trying to make our communities more aware that, if our governments, local or federal, aren't willing to stand up for their constituents and their communities, then we can. Then we need to.
Let's dig into the opioid crisis, and it's not just an opioid crisis, what you're saying, but what is the root cause, or what is at the root of the addiction crisis in this country?
Well, I think that there's not just one thing in particular. It's all connected. So part of what we're trying to make our communities aware of are that, you know, we are lacking resources to help with addiction. So part of that is, again, we want to make communities aware that, you know, harm reduction is part of this, meaning clean syringe exchanges, mental health awareness. So an addict who doesn't have health insurance, and the families are trying, or loved ones are trying to help them in some way, let's say they don't have access to health insurance. Well, there's nowhere for that addict to go except for to keep using. And so part of that is, if North Carolina would expand Medicaid, they would have access to mental health services to help them. And also, you know, an active user, if overdose happens, access to medication is very limited if you don't have health insurance. So right now, some of the medications to be used if during an overdose situation is naloxone. The brand name is Narcan. There's also the auto-injectable version called Evzio. And so let's say you do have insurance. Sometimes the insurance companies will cover most of the cost of a single-use injection. Sometimes it can be, you know, maybe around about $20 for a single dose. If you don't have insurance, it costs upwards of, you know, close to $400, anywhere from $150 to $400 for a single dose. You know, access to these medications, these life-saving medications, are important.
So these are medications to combat addiction?
It's to combat an overdose situation.
An overdose
Correct.
Situation, yes. I know police often
Correct.
So keep that on hand in case they come.
Well, and this is where we're at now, is that a few years ago, the Surgeon General issued a public health advisory, the first of its kind in 13 years, that stated pretty much everyone who has a relationship with an active user, whether it's family or neighbors or service members, meaning like paramedics or doctors, because the crisis has reached such intensity that, you know, we're losing 115 or close to that number per day from users, from ODs. And so coming back to this, is that the Surgeon General, if he's issuing a public health advisory the first in 13 years, there's a problem. If he's saying, everyone that's involved with an active user, you need to have this available on your person, because you never know. You never know when they're going to drop. And so that's the thing, is what we're saying is, if people don't have access to health care, they don't have access to life-saving medications. And I'll tell you what, I'm fairly certain if it was my family, they would do anything to see either themselves or someone else help me if I'm overdosing, and if they had to, you know, like mortgage their home or whatever for a single dose, whatever they had to do, they would. Or they would appreciate having someone else being able to help me in my crisis. And they're not attaching a price tag to that. And that's the thing, you know, like back to the medication real quick. So if you have insurance, it might be covered, these OD medications at the time. The auto-injectable version, the brand name, the Evzio, in the last 3 years, that price has jumped 680% to, I believe the figure is $4,500 for a dose. I don't know anybody, even with money, that can truly afford that, and certainly not people in small and rural counties and towns, people who don't have access to health insurance. See, all this is related, the mental health, life-saving medications, the tools and resources for substance use, counselors, rehabilitation centers, all of this is it's all combined.
I want to get back a little bit here to the reason there are so many people who are addicted to drugs and are subjected ultimately to the issue of overdosing. And I have read and I've heard a lot of discussion about the fact that the drug companies are just flooding rural communities with opioids. And I think that maybe what's happening is that people are being over-prescribed for use of opioids, for pain medication, and for almost anything these days. People are being given opioids, and that's for a lot of people, that's the beginning of a long chain of events which eventually could lead to an overdose.
Right, addiction.
But how is that, that seems, is this the doctor's fault? Is it the pharmaceutical companies that are pushing these drugs? What's the dynamics of how that has taken place? I know, in 2012, I broke my leg. And the first thing they did was try to prescribe an opioid for my pain. And I refused it. I opted for a lesser pain-relieving drug that was not a narcotic. And I didn't have any problem. The pain simply was not that great. I mean, there were times when it was bad enough. But I'm really glad I didn't get addicted to... So these days, just anybody who comes in with some kind of injury or condition in which there is some pain involved is almost automatically prescribed an opioid to relieve the pain. When did that start? I mean, that wasn't always the case.
It wasn't, and complicit in the mess that we're in now.
Mm-hmm.
Is our government, the federal government, I just a couple months ago I was reading something where they have approved a new narcotic more powerful than fentanyl. I don't remember the name, unfortunately. I wasn't actually thinking about that until just now. But and here they are saying, we care about you, we're fighting, we're in this crisis, and we're on your side, and we're going to help you, and we're going to do this, and we're going to do that, and they have done nothing except for approve another medication. It's like, I just, and because they're so good at presenting their side that it's for our benefit, people automatically assume that they're doing things for our benefit. Now, I think a lot of us are aware that money and power drive a lot of what's happening, a lot of industries, from the food industry to the sugar industry, these industries that are also complicit in addictive behavior. People are also addicted to sugar. That's one thing, food. There are just different things, and so it's like everything is in a crisis now, but it's also, I think, that the medical providers through the medical industry are also offered incentives to, how it started, incentives to provide opioids as a pain reliever. I don't think that a lot of them were aware of how addictive it could be.
That's hard to believe.
Now, but in all fairness, I say that to be fair, because I don't think it's fair to automatically include everybody to be knowingly complicit in this.
But we've known that opioids are addictive for 100
correct.
Years. I mean,
correct. Yeah. Again, I like I said, I'm I try to be careful to not include everybody
yeah.
because I understand that that's not completely fair. But yes, I think for the most part, yes, a lot of people did understand, and it is about money, incentives, which drives a lot of industries. I also think that as we progress as a society and technology enters into this, things are made a lot more convenient for us. So what I remember growing up in my family is that we had dinner time. We were supposed to sit down and have dinner with each other, have family time, remember how to communicate with one another. So there was nothing, you didn't watch TV during then, you had dinner, you did the dishes, you did your homework. I see a lot of differences in family dynamics coming up to where, you know, a lot of times it's normal to be for everyone to be on their phone, doing this on Facebook, Twitter. Some of these things that technology has presented to us to make our lives easier, I think in some instances, or a lot of instances, has been given a lot of weight and importance to the family dynamic. And I think that that is causing some of the root issues too. I mean, it's not just one thing. It is so complex. There are so many moving parts to this that it's hard to put a finger down, but I think it's safe to say as we progress as a society, we have forgotten ourselves. We've forgotten our humanity. We've forgotten compassion for one another. So again, the stigmas attached to addicts or active users is, well, something must be really wrong in your life that you can't handle, which is why you're doing this, and that's not always true. Everyone handles reactions to medications differently. Everyone's pain level, pain tolerance is different.
I think also there's some dynamic at work where, you know, we've become a society in which instant gratification is the goal rather than viewing things in the long term, you know. And so if somebody's in pain, you know, give them opioids because it will solve the problem now and we'll worry about the addiction later, you know. This is
right.
What this is how we operate, you
right
know?
Well, and that's what was presented to us. So now that we're trying some legislation coming through that, or they have tried to try to put a halt to this, well, it's a snowball effect. I mean, this has been going on for how long? And it's a mess. And so now that people are, you know, we're in desperate times, our communities are, you know, people are dying.
Yeah.
And I think it's really sad that we have this particular attitude towards people. If it doesn't directly affect me, I don't really care. It's not that that's wrong, but when it comes to loved ones dying from addiction or a mental health crisis, try explaining that to the families that are lost. I certainly understand that I've known people in crisis. You know, I've experienced my own things growing up, and we're missing that human side of the story. And we're not holding our legislators accountable for this mess that they continue to foster, this environment.
I mean, to me, it seems like it's not an accident that poor communities are being impacted more than anybody else.
Right.
It's almost, you know, it's almost back to like when Great Britain occupied China and they flooded China with opioids, you know, and then there was a revolution, or the Boxer Rebellion against, you know, it was a way of keeping the population, drugged and in, you know, so that they won't rebel, essentially, against the economic conditions that they're faced with and the poverty that they're faced with on a daily basis, it's hard to say that that's, you know, there was a decision to that made that happen, but I think just a whole series of decisions and circumstances which led to policies that allow it to happen. You know, I'm not saying there was a conspiracy, you know, but rather a systemic attitude and a systemic favoring of the people who already have wealth in this country, as opposed to in every aspect of our lives, the people who have least always get the short end of the stick, you know, always are looked down upon, and there's less effort to regulate safety measures for those communities, and less effort to safeguard those people. And even if there are laws on the books that would safeguard those communities, there's less enforcement of regulations and laws that would prevent this type of horrific, you know, scenario that's happening right now. People are dying of addiction in your communities by the thousands.
And that too is besides naloxone, which is just to help with an overdose crisis at that time. Again, mental health services, access to them, rehabilitation services, support, instead of, you know, derision and the lack of support. And also, this is, again, I'll say this again, this is about power and how people use it. And if you choose to use it to wield against your people, to keep them in place, to keep them in line, to so-called keep them happy, you know, this is what Down Home is trying to help with our communities, to say, are you really okay with elected officials or people in positions of power wielding power like that over you to keep you underneath a certain thumb? Or do you want, or should they be using their power to help empower you and your loved ones and your communities, to help enrich your lives that they keep saying that you need to be a productive citizen, a part of? Well, how am I supposed to do that? How are we supposed to do that if you continually, you know, tighten the vice, this power vice? And, you know, that saying, you know, absolute power corrupts. And that's really easy to fall into, but I think as a society, we've become complacent with how things are being presented to us. Again, they're flooding our communities with opioids for whatever reason it is. And at the same time, they're saying their actions are allowing this to happen. At the same time, they're saying, well, you know, we're not going to give you the tools to help yourself. So It's tremendously confusing. You keep saying you're helping us, but you won't help us. And we keep sitting by and letting this happen. And, you know, again, this may not seem like a very big statement, but I think talking to families that have lost loved ones due to addiction or in the process of losing them, it's scary. You know, they would rather have their loved ones here with them, even going through rehab, than either watching them die in front of them or knowing they've died alone or depressed, that all comes with addiction. You know, how about talking to those families? How about actually letting them know that you care? How about doing something? And this is, again, on us as a population and on our legislators. You know, I know that there have been some people that have made an effort, but the bill dies because nobody's interested in doing something about it, something truly, truly worthy, you know, of us. And this is what it's about.
If you were queen.
Queen for a day. I'll take that.
But what steps would be taken legislatively, regulatory, in the regulatory agencies? What do we need to do to address this problem effectively?
Well, we need to start holding legislators that say they represent us accountable for their voting records and their voting actions, which can be looked up online or you go to a library and find out. I mean, I think the first step is to find out who actually is putting their money where their mouth is. And that's hard. It's researched. It's lengthy. There's a lot of stuff to look at. But there are some sites like votesmart.org that kind of puts it in layman's terms. You can plug in a politician's name and it comes up with their voting records, especially for North Carolina, since obviously you live in North Carolina. It can tell you what key votes, how they voted, yay or nay on bills.
Okay.
What I'm saying, though, yeah. I think what I found out recently is to look and see how they are voting. They act, and because there's a lot of things that come through the legislation that people aren't aware of. Bills that die immediately, just don't have enough support. And that's one thing, is to see who actually is making the effort to introduce legislation that gives us the tools to help us where we need it.
Okay, what I'm asking is, what are those tools? What things have to be done, assuming that we could get legislators to vote for them? What's the content of the bill that you're asking?
I don't necessarily know it's as simple as that. What I can say, just from my own awareness, is that passing Medicaid expansion is truly key, because it involves access to life-saving medication, because it involves access to mental health care. And these are huge parts. Like I said, this is one of the other platforms we've been fighting with the legislation about, Medicaid expansion. You know, our communities that don't have access to these things, we can't do anything. We are dead in the water. All we can do is watch people that we love die. And again, another part of that is finding out how your legislators voted. Do they actually care? Like I said, it's so complex. There are so many moving parts. These are just the small ones that I can attest to from my awareness. And I guess, you know, again, the next step is to start confronting with direct action legislators that are involved in this and say, you know, I think actually there are legislators now are going into session without, they didn't pass Medicaid expansion. They're going to stall.
And the governor vetoed the bill.
And now they're wanting to, you know, see if they can come up with enough votes to override that veto.
Right.
But in the meantime, they're just going to go out on hiatus or whatever they're doing and enjoy themselves without getting their work that they were elected to do done. I mean, here we are, and because this is important to our communities, different groups and different individuals and families, here we are, you know, needing to do the legwork. And that's okay, but they should be doing the legwork. They should be doing more legislative work that impacts us. It's like, so I don't understand why it's okay for you just to pretend like this isn't important. It's important to me. It's important to my community. It's important to active users and their families, but it's not important enough. It's these barriers that keep being thrown into our faces through our local governments, and I can't attest to why. I can only assume, and that may not be fair, but it just shows the lack of compassion. I don't know what it is. I wish I could attest to it. They are completely out of touch, and they're unwilling to see the human component of this. Is that we're human beings. I think, as I said earlier, we do human things. Sometimes they're right, sometimes they're wrong, sometimes they're in between, but we're human beings. And just because you look at me and automatically assume that, you assume whatever you assume, that's not right either. Snap judgment. It's like all of this is hugely judgmental against the population, the constituents that don't have health care coverage, the addicts, all of these things that these judgments are made about. It's like, well, you don't know me. You don't know my community. And obviously you don't care because you have not stepped foot over here to find out what's happening. It's like I said, there are so many moving components that it's hard to nail down with just one specific thing. But you know, we have to start at the bottom. Start from the ground up and keep clawing our way forward. And this is, I think we're reaching a point that organizations that are pushing for our communities to be healthy and successful and recognized, you know, things are going to get not so nice anymore. Just because a lot, you know, some people are starting to understand and acknowledge that this is insane. When you lose, you know, 115 people per day, I think it might have been per hour. It's just insane. It's hard to wrap your brain around, and especially when you're not directly impacted by it. You know, sometimes the figures go in and out. You know, you hear it, and then it is. But for the families that are hurting and that are dying, it means something to them.
You know, my audience knows I've pointed this out before, but not only in North Carolina, but let's talk about North Carolina since that's what we're dealing with here. We have a very aristocratic system of government in North Carolina. We have a part-time state legislature. Because that's really a vestige of when this was a small rural state, and we were able to operate on a part-time basis. We're no longer a small rural state. We're I think the ninth largest state in the country, and we have several major industrial centers and large cities, Charlotte and Raleigh and Durham and Greensboro and Asheville but we still operate as if we're a small aristocratic state, and we have this part-time state legislature that's paid very minimally. I'm not mistaken, I think senators get $20,000 a year and representatives get $13,000 or something in that neighborhood a year for being so-called part-time state legislators. And you can talk to any state legislator, they'll tell you it's not a part-time job. It's a full-time job. So the dynamic of it is, and if you live like in the western part of the state or in the eastern part of the state, you have to maintain two homes. You're a state legislator. You know, one in Raleigh and one in your home district. So what it amounts to is that the only people who can afford to run for public office as state legislators in North Carolina are people who are either independently wealthy or are getting money from somebody who's got a lot of money.
Right.
And so what that leaves us with is a representation that represents the upper class, you know, and people who are indeed out of touch with the problems of poor, even if there are poor communities in their own district, that's not where these legislators live. They live in the wealthier parts of their districts. And they they're subjected to a whole different set of problems than the people who are, you know, are suffering acute problems, economic issues, mental health issues, you know, poverty, basically. And so it's, you know, it makes it difficult to communicate if you're a grassroots activist with legislators who are so out of touch with the problems of poor communities. So it really goes to the basic grassroots level of how we're governed and the system of government we live under, you know. And then you add into that the whole issue of gerrymandering and and the money in politics, then you see the disadvantage that we're at, you know, that we have in attempting to address this issue from a legislative level.
I agree. And I mean, I who's to say what happens from here? I just feel like that, you know, there are people that are, you know, average citizens, some from upper class, some from middle, some from lower, that are just sick and tired of what's happening and of what's not happening. It's the lack of action, the lack of complacency that's just...
There's no urgency there on the part of
the
people who are governing us.
You know, and we know that overdose crises have moved into have already started moving into upper class neighborhoods, affecting doctors and attorneys, you know, college kids. I mean, people situations that look at it and say, oh, well, you know, they're obviously upper or middle class. This affects all classes. And so that's the thing. It's like, how do you not acknowledge that? It's, you know, but it comes back to, oh, well, it must be the poor and lower caste communities. You know, it's their fault. They can't get it together. They're all addicts.
It's the immigrants.
It's the immigrants,
all the drugs,
you know,
yeah,
it's the people
right.
that just want to live off of, you know, government programs. Well,
right.
you know, I, for one, had assistance in that. And it's, you know, even though that's not part of the overdose crisis, that's another factor, another judgment. Oh, well, you're using government assistance, so obviously you're okay with that. It's like, not really, but I need the help. And that what that does is it helps me be a productive citizen. I'm at least taking advantage of something to help me. Whereas, you know, that is one thing I can say the state of North Carolina has been good about, has been helpful with. And yet the flip side of that is my lack of access to health care. I'm in a Medicaid gap. I have been for a long time, and fighting tooth and nail with the pharmaceutical companies to get my life-saving medication. You know, it's just weird. It's like we're being fed a line of BS and expected to fall in line and be okay with it. Yet, in the same instance, it's really confusing. The distortion of the facts that we're being given and information about our communities is just that, it's a distortion. And so people are, of course, they're confused, and it's so much. There is so much going on in the world today that is so incredibly that is so dire that it's really hard for people to keep up with. And so sometimes these things do fall by the wayside because people are like, I just need to be able to pay my bills. I need to be able to go to work. I need to be able to put food on my table. I need to be able to do all these things that are important in our day-to-day lives. But again, access to Medicaid expansion, access to healthcare helps get me off the couch and doesn't at all disincentivize me to not go to work. The other side of that is not being alive, and I value my life. You know, and my family values my life as I try to value the lives of others. And so it's like a hodgepodge. It's just a mess of all these things, and people are just... some people are just trying to do the best they can to make these things aware. And so, again, the movie screening for Thursday is about you know, how to survive a plague, which is what they were trying to do, to stay alive in the 80s during the AIDS crisis. And we're now, the overdose deaths have surpassed the peak of the AIDS statistics back then, and it doesn't seem to be slowing down anytime soon. And so we are trying to empower our communities to step up and say, you can be a part of this. You know, we don't expect everyone to jump in and say, hey, I'm going to dedicate my entire life to this. But there are things that you can do. There are events you can attend. There are phone calls you can make. Different things. There are other organizations besides Down Home you can become members of to help. Not everybody wants to be specifically a member of Down Home. We have people that are members of a couple organizations besides Down Home. It's just really important that people know that we are here and that we hear you. We understand. A lot of us have either experienced or been a part of an overdose crisis. We've lost loved ones. We see people losing them every day. It's scary. We empathize. We care, and we're here. And you can be. We want you to be a part of this. This doesn't work unless we all, you know, come to the understanding that this, we are in a crisis, and we don't want to live like this, and it's not necessary.
So what have you got in that envelope?
They were just some extra paperwork I brought with me for with some different facts on it in case I had forgotten something, but I think I hit most everything. And some of this actually I won't go into because we really extend the invitation for people to come to the movie screening. So a lot of this will be mentioned at the movie screening too. Mm-hmm. So I can't give it all away, but again, it is at the Cooperative Extension on Skyland, 876 Skyland, from 5:30 to 7:30. The week after that, we will have a community discussion about that. And so in
here
the meantime,
in
it will be here in Sylva, and we'll give some more of that, more information. We're also looking at one of our other engagements we're looking at is the living wage employer certifications, which again, you can read more about that on our website, or these are upcoming engagements and events as well. Right now, besides the Medicaid expansion, we're going into the overdose crisis and response and how we need to respond as communities to all of this.
Okay, so that's Thursday, 5:30 at the Community Services Building at the Cooperative Extension.
Right, in Skyland.
On Skyland.
Right.
And
just very quickly, I'm sorry, it's not the full two-hour documentary. We cut it down to about a little over an hour, I believe.
Okay.
Just for bits and pieces, because it can be long, and we know that not everybody has that time, but we also, you know, invite people to invite people. You know, please, you know, get the word
free.
Out.
It's free.
And it's free. That's
yes.
Absolutely correct. We also have our regular Jackson County Down Home North Carolina chapter meeting this Saturday, which is the 27th, at 4 o'clock at St. John's Episcopal.
Okay.
It's 18 Jackson Street here in Sylva. And my name is Carrie. I'm a part-time organizer for Down Home North Carolina. My information is also on the website, but of course, I can also give you the email or phone number if you like, and I will also be at the movie screening and at the community meeting, and also Chelsea White will be there. She's our full-time organizer for Jackson and Haywood County, so we are just looking to get as much community engagement and involvement as possible during these trying times.
And how can people get in touch with you if they want to?
Yes, so I can either be emailed at Carrie, which is spelled C-A-R-R-I-E, at downhomenc.org, or if you'd like to make a phone call, you can also reach me at 828-506-4817, and leave me a message if I don't answer. And again, we also have the information listed on downhomenc.org as well.
Thank you, Karen.
Oh, you're welcome.
For
thank
your
you.
Work, and thanks for coming today.
Yeah, thank you very much. I appreciate the invite and for the platform. You know, it's really important, all different platforms and levels of engagement. So, yeah, thank you. Thank you, too.